evil is a word that's appropriate to use. I think literally when you have a kind of visceral reaction, your mouth drops open. You think, this has crossed a line somewhere. This ought not to have happened because it changes our relation to the world. And it is a feeling that the ground has dropped out from under your feet, that the framework and the rules by which you use to decide what's good and bad are suddenly shifted, and suddenly you actually don't know how to function in your world where that can happen. That line should never have been crossed. And now that it's been crossed, it's always a possibility again. The problem of evil looks at first glance like a theological problem. So the question of how we could find meaning or how we could live with horrible evil and suffering was in the first instance a question about how God could permit it to happen. Now, for Voltaire, when the Lisbon earthquake happened, it threw the goodness, the benevolence, the systematicity, the order of creation into question, because God had produced such a marvelous world that it worked perfectly on its own. And all of the sudden you had this gigantic glitch, as it is in creation. You have a world that seems to be working, and all of a sudden, for no reason, a major city is wiped out in a couple of minutes. Rousseau was the first person to really confront the problem of evil in all its seriousness outside of a purely theological framework, and to come up with an explanation of evil that's naturalistic. It doesn't depend on grace, it doesn't depend on a miracle. It says human beings can understand evil. They can understand it because evil is something historical. It didn't come into being in the Garden of Eden. You can explain how it happens in naturalistic terms. And if we can understand how it happened, we have a chance of understanding how to undo it. The year 1945 saw two extraordinary cases of evil. One is the revelations of just how extensive and outrageous the Holocaust was first became known to a general public, and shortly after that the bomb was dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Those are two completely different kinds of evil. Arendt's phrase, the banality of evil, has been misunderstood, and she was vilified for coming up with that phrase. She did not ever mean to say that the evil was banal. it's we who are banal. It's evildoers who are banal. And in describing the character of Adolf Eichmann, she described somebody who was not a demon, not malevolent, neither filled with hatred for Jews, nor with lust for killing anybody. In fact, the one time he actually watched a mass murder, he claims that it made him sick, and it probably did. This was somebody who was a bureaucrat and a career man, somebody who was just trying to get ahead, and who was willing literally to walk over corpses in order to do so. She thinks that if you can explain evil as something that's not mysterious, that's not demonic, but actually, I mean, what does banal mean? Banal means ordinary, it means commonplace, it means something that you can explain. If you can explain the occurrence of evil, there isn't a horrible mystery at the heart of the cosmos, so to speak. There's something that we can do something about. I think it's very important for all of us who are critical of Bush and critical of his response to 9/11 and critical of his abuse of 9/11 that we don't go so far overboard as to deny that 9/11 was evil. I wouldn't call the terrorists banal in the same way that Eichmann was, but they are deeply committed to a series of ideals. And if we don't realize that and acknowledge that, we have absolutely no chance of undercutting that.
Just 3 days removed from these events, Americans do not yet have the distance of history. But our responsibility to history is already clear. To answer these attacks and rid the world of evil.
Unfortunately, we could have had the world on our side, and we probably certainly could have destroyed Al-Qaeda by now, had we acted in concert with the other nations who felt that what had been done on September 11th was indeed evil and felt tremendous sympathy with the United States. We couldn't have done it by saying we had a mission to rid the world of evil. This is not how evil works.
Wenn mehr Zivilcourage gewesen wäre, dann wäre alles anders gekommen. Sind Sie anderer
Sicherlich, wenn die Zivilcourage ebenfalls hierarchisch aufgebaut gewesen wäre, ganz klar. Ja.
When you think about the case of Eichmann, and you think about not even Eichmann himself, but the people who drove the trains, the people who manufactured Cyclone B, all of them much more banal than Eichmann himself, the Holocaust couldn't have been carried out without very small acts of evil by people who were acting as part of a machine in ways that they should have stopped and thought about what they were doing. And goodness works exactly the same way. I think it's a great mistake to think of good and evil as all or nothing affairs. And I think if we look around, we can think of lots of small things we can do. By themselves, they won't change the world, but they'll change a piece of it. If all of us do that, we'll be able to keep, as Arendt said, the planet a place that's fit for human habitation.